every once in a while, a movie will come in that was made especially for the fans. I'm not talking about a movie that fans of something can watch, but more casual viewers can also watch and get pretty much the same experience. No, I'm talking about something that clearly is aiming for a certain fandom and appeals mainly to them. Not strictly, mind you, but they're definitely the preference. Spider-Man No Way Home is definitely one of these kinds of films. Now, don't worry, I'll let you know when I spoil the film. It's actually kind of important to talk about the final act to really emphasize this fact, but don't worry, I'll let you know when it comes. But I think the best way to describe this film is, simply put, a love letter. But what kind of letter? Well, we'll get to that in the spoiler section. Picking up immediately after Far From Home, Peter's identity has been revealed to the whole world, and now he's having trouble with a huge chunk of the world believing that he's a murderer. He and his friends can't get away from it, so he goes to Doctor Strange to try and cast a spell that'll erase everyone's memory. Of course, the spell goes haywire, and before you know it, villains from other universes are coming into his. Doc Ock, Green Goblin, Sandman, and a couple others. And no, this is not a spoiler. This has literally been seen in pretty much every trailer. I don't know what to tell you if this was actually spoiled for you just now. As expected from a Marvel movie, everything on a technical level is great. It's so freaking cool to see Doc Ock's tentacles and Sandman in modern CGI. I think the older movies still look good, especially Spider-Man 2, but come on, compared to now, it just looks so freaking good. The fight scenes are also spectacular. No, that wasn't a pun. The fight scenes really are spectacular. The final fight is definitely one for the books, in ways I can't really get into yet, because, you know, spoilers, but man, the way it all came together just felt so natural with the film's message. The message, of course, being Spider-Man's greatest philosophy. And, of course, I'm sure you know what it is. The comedy is, once again, pretty funny. It's not really until the last third does this movie really step it up in terms of comedy. A lot of this, of course, really comes from the chemistry between the characters and how they interact with each other. I remember people when they were leaving the theater and they could not stop talking about this one particular part that was just so incredibly satisfying to see, but it was also easily the funniest scene in the whole movie. That, of course, isn't to say this movie is all laughs, of course, because this movie will make you cry. Very much so. There's a serious moment at the end of the second act that I didn't think this movie had the balls to even do, but they did it. And I hate them for it. No, not because it was bad, but because how dare you, Marvel? How dare you break my heart like this? Who do you fucking think you are, Don Bluth? You monsters! But with that being said, it really did help tie in with Peter's arc of accepting the responsibility that's been bestowed upon him. Even though I like Tom Holland as Spider-Man, this is probably the most he's felt like Spider-Man. Homecoming was about him learning how to become a hero. Far From Home was about him trying to become Tony's successor, but No Way Home was about him learning how to become Spider-Man. And that's really emphasized by the way the movie ends. Again, without spoiling things, there are consequences to Peter's actions, and he has to live with them in the end. Looking back on the other Spider-Man franchises, this is what it's always been about, hasn't it? Or at least try to in some regard. Tobey's Spider-Man blamed himself for Uncle Ben's death, while Andrew's Spider-Man feels like he failed to save Gwen Stacy. It really all comes back to responsibility in the end. But to talk more about that, here's where I have to mark spoilers. So, skip to this part of the video here for the final words. So, here you go. 3, 2, 1, pumpkin bombs. So, I think I speak for everyone on the internet when I say I was not surprised at all. I knew exactly what they were doing, and frankly, I'm still very happy about it. This was probably the worst kept secret in history. We all knew they were gonna show up. You can't bring in Doc Ock and Electro and all these guys and yet not bring in Toby and Andrew. Seriously, who on earth did they think they were fooling? But yeah, Toby and Andrew are in the movie and they, alongside Tom, fight the villains together. And admittedly, this is the most fun I've had in a Spider-Man movie since Spider-Verse. That isn't to say it's completely perfect. There is the scene where the two are introduced, and while it was funny for a bit, it honestly kind of dragged for a while. There was this joke where MJ didn't trust Andrew, so she tells him to prove that he's Spider-Man, even though he's literally wearing his fucking costume. So he sticks to the ceiling, but apparently that's not enough? Like, we get it. I'm happy to see them both, but this is a little ridiculous, to be frank. There's also this emotional scene where all three Peters are talking about all that they've lost, and Toby and Andrew go on about Uncle Ben and Gwen Stacy, and I'm all like, okay, I get this is meant to kind of play catch-up and stuff, but yeah, we kind of get it at this point. And look, I get it. There's probably people who haven't even seen the other Spider-Man movies. Some kids will probably think of them as old people movies, and frankly, that's just another valid reason to hate children. I just wish they cut the scene down a bit, because it's like 5 minutes long. Like, seriously. But as soon as it wraps up, it gets good again. The chemistry these three have is truly phenomenal. It is exactly what you would think these three would talk about. They ask Toby how he's able to shoot webs out of his body as opposed to being forced to make his own. They bring up their history with the villains. They do this at one time for fuck's sake and it didn't feel forced at all. Seriously, it's like a super well-written fanfiction story. I'm dead serious. But what really makes all of this work is the way they tie into almost all of the villains. You can tell the people behind this movie just really unequivocally love Spider-Man. They don't give any special treatment to one particular Spider-Man. It feels like they all get the right amount of love here. Toby, Andrew, and Tom. This, in some ways, feels almost like the Spider-Man 4 or the Amazing Spider-Man 3 that we never got. It seriously follows up on certain scenes and even plot threads from their respective franchises and gives us genuinely satisfying interactions, and in one case, even a redemption, which, as I said before, had my theater howling with applause. And even though I personally am not the biggest fan of the Amazing Spider-Man movies, I still felt what that moment represented. And that's a really cool thing about this movie. It didn't pick a side or have a favorite Spider-Man. Instead, it gave all fans of Spider-Man at least something to root for. Toby got love and Andrew got love. And I respect that shit wholeheartedly. Even the villains, in some weird way, almost all have their own redemptions, and it ties in beautifully with their respective franchises. Doc Ock, Green Goblin, Electro, you name it. All except for Sandman for some reason. Yeah, I don't really get what they were doing with Sandman. From what I remember in Spider-Man 3, Sandman and Peter were cool in the end, and he wasn't really a villain? Okay, yeah, he was a villain, but he was redeemed in the end. Plus, all he was doing was looking out for his daughter. So I don't get why he's suddenly super untrusting and just okay with trying to help Electro and Lizard take over the world, because, like, that's never what he wanted, and it just felt insanely forced and under character for him. I'm sorry. Green Goblin, though. Holy fuck, I love Green Goblin in this. Willem Dafoe comes back in this one, and man, he is hamming it up just like he did all those years ago. He was born to be the Goblin, and you can't convince me otherwise. They even update his costume in this movie, and it looks just like the comics! I know there's some people out there who hated the suit in the Sam Raimi movies, so hopefully they'll be pleased by what we get here. The movie does at times feel like it's retconning things in those franchises, like the fact that some of these villains won't have to die now, but honestly for me, it still felt super satisfying for me because, again, it all ties back to who Spider-Man is. Now, I didn't say Tom, or Toby, or Andrew, I said Spider-Man, the web-slinger who has been entertaining generations since 1962. Nothing about Tom wanting to save their lives, despite them being villains, feels out of character. And a lot of that comes from what Aunt May taught him to do, to help people whenever he can, even if they probably don't deserve it. I also love how the other two Spider-Men don't even argue. They 100% agree because that's who Spider-Man is. They help people. That's the bottom line. Nothing about this movie betrays the characters from the other franchises. If anything, this movie respects them all by bringing back all of the actors and staying true to everything that's happened in all of the Spider-Man movies when they could have easily retconned it. They even referenced Electro's teeth at one point, man. Yeah, remember the teeth thing that a lot of people thought was really goofy and stupid? They could have easily retconned that or just not brought it up at all, but no, they did. They acknowledged that. Like, seriously, guys, props to them for doing that. If anyone asked me, I'd still say Spider-Verse is my favorite Spider-Man movie overall, but while Spider-Verse was a love letter to Spider-Man in the comics, this is a love letter to Spider-Man in the movies. They even make a joke about a black Spider-Man at one point. Yeah, I guess bringing Miles on board was on the table, but yeah, I guess that was just a little too much for Sony to say yes to, since they technically still own Spider-Man. Yeah, what are you gonna do? I'm honestly amazed with just how much this movie loves Spider-Man in general. I guess I could talk more about Doctor Strange or MJ or Ned, but honestly, is that what you're really interested in? I mean, don't get me wrong, they're great characters, but we all know why we're really here. We all know why we really went to see this movie, and we also knew exactly what we were gonna get out of it. Don't pretend you didn't know what was in this movie. I guess I can understand why some people wouldn't like this movie, since it does rely a lot on fan service, and I can understand that, but frankly, I think it all really worked out in the long run. This movie still stands perfectly well in its own right, and if you have that nostalgic connection to the other franchises, then it just adds more to the emotional weight and comedy that this movie brings. So personally, I thought this was amazing. No, that wasn't a pun either. Stop it! So, if you're a Spider fan like I am, be it old or new, this movie has everything for you. It doesn't hate, it unites. So swing into the movies for a trip that's almost 20 years and 3 franchises in the making. But in case anyone asks, Toby's the best. Now goodbye.